Fortunately, I worked for 5 years before I went into broadcasting, which gave me a taste of the real world. And in a way, I found that very good because you knew what was going on in other places. Because inside radio studios, everyone thinks the same, and it's just a different life. I started in broadcasting on the 12th of September 1954. Couldn't be that long ago. He's too young, okay? It's true. And I started at a radio station 3UL in Warrigal in Victoria, which was part of the Argus Broadcasting Network. A few years later, the Argus ceased to exist, and 3UL also doesn't exist. I deny having anything to do with it. But that was my journey in country radio, and you wouldn't want to start any other way. However, a couple of years later, or less than 2 years later, I was asked to audition at 3AW in Melbourne, and that was every young man's wish and ambition to be in the big city. So there I was, pretty scared, but working with some well-known names, people I'd grown up listening to, like Happy Hammond, Norman Banks, and John Masters, and it was a learning curve. I must say that when I started at Warrigal and again at 3AW, it was still in the time of 78 records. In Warrigal, I think they had 4 LPs and everybody wanted to play them in the program. And when I went to 3AW, it was still 78, and some of the top records came out on both 78 and 45, as Henry Gage will well recall. But it was a wonderful time. It was pre-television and it was pre-rock and roll. And every radio station covered the whole gamut of broadcasting. There were no formats in those days. So you had the experience of being a newsreader, classical music presenter, a popular music presenter. Not so many interviews, but it was a wonderful crowd. I know I only have 5 minutes, so we'll skip forward. I was there for 12 years. I started at 3AW on the 12th of September 54 and left the day before Richmond won the grand final in 1967 when they thrashed Geelong. Then I had many years at the ABC from 1967 through to 1980, and then a commercial FM was starting, and I was getting a bit cheesed off with the ABC and thought, well, maybe I should give this a try. And one of the stations starting up was called Fox FM. Well, it wasn't called anything at the time. We didn't know what it was going to be called, but it turned out to be Fox. And they had a broad spectrum of music, and that appealed to me. I was never really a great pop music person, although I'd been very much involved in it at 3AW in the late 50s when the rock revolution started. But the only reason I was because I was the youngest guy on staff. I was about 21 or 22. But my time at the ABC encompassed all of those skills one had learned earlier. Rather than being in format radio, there was a chance to work for Radio Australia, the ABC service of the ABC, and on home service, we covered the whole gamut, and in 1 week you could be on the heavy music network, be a newsreader on Radio Australia, be coordinating the sports panel as I did for about 12 or 15 years on Saturday afternoon. And I'm moving around a bit here, but I went to Fox, and after all the millions that were spent granting the license and being told yes, it would be a comprehensive broadcasting thing, which appeared to me. A year later, the heavies moved in. I came to work in the afternoon. They said, hey, all this has changed. It's a rock and roll station now. So I said, well, where do I go? They said, well, you can take 4 weeks holiday if you like and we'll pay you. I said, well, okay. Fortunately, I hadn't burnt any bridges at the ABC and was able to go back there for another 7 or 8 years. In between times as well, 5 minutes up here. in the meantime, as well as doing the broadcasting, back in the early 60s, I was asked to introduce one of the American jazz acts on stage at the Festival Hall. That was the Dave Brubeck Quartet. And that started something. I got very much involved in emceeing a lot of the jazz shows with visiting artists, people like Oscar Peterson and Dizzy Gillespie and Duke Ellington, as well as the Australian acts. And I was lucky enough to introduce some of those acts at various places, including Sydney Opera House, which was wonderful, out in the vineyards in the Hunter Valley, and that was a nice little side thing. So all of that finished in 1988 when, for the first time in my broadcasting life, I didn't enjoy getting up and going to work in the morning. And that was sad, but you know, I had to bite the bullet, and so I came up here. So to play golf 4 times a week, live in the sunshine. A few years later, I did some filling work for Mr. Cam Young's radio station, the ABC in Maroochydore. I did that for 4 or 5 years, doing a month or two a year, which was nice. And then some community radio at Noosa in the late 1990s. And then it all came to a stop until last year. And I got a call from some people concerned with the radio station in, oh, here's the camera, the radio station in suburban Melbourne called Radio Eastern. They said, we'd like you to do something for us. I said, well, what can I do? And they said, well, you know, you'll think of something. So I've got 4,000 or 5,000 LP records at home. And we came up with the way to do it with the microphone and the records and a computer. And I now do about one a month, a 1 hour program, which I send out. I burn onto the CD and send out, and have a lot of fun playing Peggy Lee and Tony Bennett and the George Shearing Quintet and all of that lovely stuff. So this 78 is still spinning. Thank you very much.
We know theme, it'll just be come along, have a few drinks and enjoy the meal. And just a matter of interest, very quickly, everybody happy with the meal? I ask that all the time, just to make sure that we're all happy, and we're in open place. Henry Gay, you've got something to say.
I was going to ask that you've given 5 minutes or 10 minutes, much better, but I would like the opportunity for them to answer a few questions.
We could do that now. Would you like to ask some questions? Are you happy to ask some questions?
I'm not
going to do that.
Well, I'll keep that secret. The girl told me she's keeping the baby.
I'll share the story with you now. Henry and I have a mutual friend. His name's Ray Sharp, and he's 92 tomorrow. He was an old friend of my family's, and he worked with Henry in Melbourne. He was at Channel 9, days of Brad Kennedy, and when 3AK was there. And he always used to say, he's told me this story so many times, he's suffering with dementia. So he used to love looking up the telephone book for Henry Gay, because he used to come up, Gay, Henry. So I just like to share that with you. Thank you for your
My other boy already said the same thing.
It's not a question, but it's quite hard to say that Ralph is good to hear you speak. When Ralph worked for COVID event for a short time, he used to drive us nuts every time he'd get on the wire and the phone would just go nuts. And people would say, gee, it's good to hear Ralph back. They were all women, of course. So yeah. But anybody else? Want to ask any questions of standing at all, please feel free.
Any questions
about yes, Benny Pike.
Your husband, John, was a 4G.
Yes, and you used to...
I'll tell a story. I was working in Brisbane with this guy.
Thank you, Ben.
I was working in Brisbane with John on this week as well, and I got a phone call, and it was John Ford. He said, mate, what are you doing? So I said, would you like to come up and talk to the triathlon? And I went, oh, that's terrific. I'll do that. I said, I'm off. Jump in the car and I'm driving up and I went, what's a triathlon? I had no idea. And we turned up and there was a truck just backed in the thing. There were two speakers there, 200 competitors, a little bit different now, 200 competitors, the bikes of the Melbourne Stars or Hash were just laying on the ground and they had Dunlop shoes, like all that stuff. Just towels and it was sitting anyway. So off they went, they dived in the water, they swam up the canal, that took 30 of them, it's not like this about it. So I'm going, I don't know what to say. Anyway, they get on the bike and off they go. And the bike went now from cool out to cool in that. So they're away 2 hours. What am I going to say? And all of a sudden this bike in the crowd's gone, right. I ran out of a cowboy hat on, with jeans on, came up and he said, but I'm a singing cowboy. And I said, really? So I'm a lot of the name of Shark. I'm singing. I said, really? He said, there's the microphone. Next week we started singing, hey, hello, River. And for the next 2 hours, he's playing songs. And I went, like, here they come. I go, well, there they go again, there's the microphone. And he played the song and he sang again. They came back, so I said, yeah. Brought him back in and I said to John, thanks for that. That was it, and that was the first ever Lucid Triathlon. That was it. So John.
Well, just as well, it wasn't the 100
metre
dash or something.
But I've never seen a bloke ever again. If I ever see him, I'm going to thank him.
I don't know that that's the first time I've ever heard that many people have lost for words. Enjoy the rest of the day. See you in September. Good time for a song. Good. Thanks.
in your direction.
It didn't matter.